Welcome, everyone. Welcome to the 2021 Interventional Radiology Review course. So we have a packed agenda for you all here today. We're going to go through three case review lectures and two didactic lectures. So the way we'll do it is we'll do an arterial rapid review session followed by a talk on tips. And then we'll have Dr. Abdullahian speak on prostate artery embolization followed by venous review cases. And Dr. Chow talk about non-vascular cases. So since we have a limited amount of time and a lot of information, let's go ahead and get started. So I do not have any disclosures or any company affiliations that I need to report. So the first case, this is a 38-year-old female from Nepal that presented to the emergency department with massive hemoptysis. The approximate volume of hemoptysis was about 500 milliliters, and the patient has a history of tuberculosis. So this patient was referred to angiography, and we have a reverse curve catheter that has selected the left bronchial artery. And once we select that artery and inject, we can see there is a grossly abnormal vessel here. So the bronchial artery, it's tortuous, it's hypertrophied. And also we see an abnormal connection to what looks like the pulmonary vein here. So the way we treated this was we did a bronchial artery embolization. And just to go through the most pertinent information on the slides, so hemoptysis resulting in pulmonary or hemodynamic compromise needs therapeutic intervention. The most common cause worldwide is tuberculosis. However, in the United States, it's usually due to a chronic inflammatory process, such as cystic fibrosis. In the literature, hemoptysis ranges from anywhere from 200 to 1,000 milliliters. So really, it's just anywhere in that range. The most frequently documented is about 300 milliliters. And what you're looking for on angiography, if you take a look at the table on the right, you're looking for hypertrophied or enlarged bronchial arteries, kind of like what we see here. It's hypertrophied and enlarged. You may see a bronchial artery aneurysm. You may see shunting to the pulmonary vein or artery. And finally, you can see active extravasation, but really you only see active extravasation in about 10% of patients. And so don't use that as the only sign for to see if there's an abnormality or not. Moving to the next case, this is a 40-year-old female with hypertension that is not well controlled with medical management. Again, we've taken this patient to angio, and we have a reverse curve catheter that selected the renal artery. And as we inject, digital subtracted angiography demonstrates multiple abnormalities. You see multiple areas of narrowing followed by dilation here. So this is a pretty classic appearance for fibromuscular dysplasia. And again, taking a look at this, just to reiterate, you see alternating beading here or alternating areas of stricturing followed by dilation. So there is a classification system for FMD, with the most common being the medial type. You'll see medial dysplasia in about 70%, and the medial type accounts for 90 to 95%, with the intimal type classifying or ranging from around 5%, and the adventitial type being rare. It's an unknown prevalence. It's idiopathic. It's not inflammatory, and it's non-atherosclerotic either. So it's most frequently asymptomatic, and really the patients that you will see that have this they have refractory hypertension. And again, the most common angiographic sign is this string of beads appearance, which you can see here. And that's another radiology classic. The most common locations in the renal arteries, but they can really happen in any other vascular system. Case three is a 55-year-old male with tearing substernal chest pain and dyspnea at rest. This is a CT angiogram. Axial slices demonstrate a pretty clear aortic dissection. And this dissection is extending into what is a aberrant right subclavian artery. It's the most common, an aberrant right subclavian artery is the most common congenital anomaly of the aortic arch. Mostly they're asymptomatic. However, you can get dysphagia, lusoria due to esophageal compression. And in that case, if that were to happen, then surgery is warranted for the aberrant rights of Clavien artery. Regardless, this patient has the aortic dissection, so they'll need treated no matter what. It's associated with other congenital anomalies, including congenital heart disease, Down syndrome, anomalous recurrent laryngeal nerve, and you may have a thoracic duct that terminates on the right. Moving forward, this is a 70-year-old male that presents the emergency department with a cold right lower extremity. This patient came to angiography, and we selected, went up and over the horn with our catheter and sheath. And as we inject, there's an acute occlusion that's extending from the distal SFA as it enters the adductor canal. And there's a previously placed stent that is down here that's completely occluded. And so the way we treat these is we basically will try to cross this with a wire, and we'll either do lysis, and if it's chronic, we may recanalize depending on the situation. But in this particular case, because this was an acute thrombosis, we performed lysis on this patient. The patient had overnight lysis. We were able to cross the stent, angioplasty, and restore flow back to the lower extremity. So this patient had critical limb ischemia, which led to catheter-directed lysis. There are specific indications for catheter-directed thrombolysis, which includes acute limb-threatening ischemia, pulmonary embolism, lower extremity venous thrombosis, upper extremity thrombosis, or portal vein thrombosis. Contraindications to catheter-directed lysis are active bleeding or uncorrectable coagulopathy if the patient's dissected, if there's a recent history of hemorrhagic stroke, head trauma, or an intracranial neoplasm. Complications can occur with any sort of lysis. The most common complication is hemorrhage, but you can also have distal emboli, vessel dissection, and reperfusion syndrome. I will say that in 2021, catheter-directed lysis has taken a backseat to more thrombectomy-type procedures. In our practice here, we are doing more thrombectomies for pulmonary embolism and lower extremity thrombosis at this point. And so as the technology improves, we are seeing less and less catheter-directed lysis, but there are still indications for it. The next case is a 67-year-old male with bilateral buttock and thigh pain with walking very short distances. This is another radiology classic type of case. On these cross-sectional CT angio images, the aorta is patent, and then all of a sudden the aorta goes out. And then on this MIP reconstructed image, there's occlusion of the aorta by iliac system here. Most of the times, this is a chronic condition. This is not something that happens overnight usually. And this is called Larich syndrome or aortic occlusion. If it's acute, you'll see a filling defect with few collaterals. If it's chronic, you'll see aortic occlusion with extensive collateralization. The triad of Larich syndrome is abdominal or aortic occlusive disease that causes absent femoral pulses, bilateral claudication, and impotence. Surgery is the gold standard. However, there are some practices that will recanalize and stent through this. The image here on the right demonstrate some of the collateral pathways that are prominent that form during Larich syndrome, and you can take a look at these as well. The next case is a 50-year-old male with chronic persistent hand pain. This patient is a carpenter. This is an angiogram, and what you can see here is the radial artery is filling appropriately. And when you see the ulnar artery, there's sluggish flow, and there's an area here where it is not filling through. Another classic case, this is hypothenar hammer syndrome. This occurs from repetitive trauma to the distal ulnar artery and the proximal portion of the superficial palmar arch. It's originally described in patients using hammers and screwdrivers, but really can happen in anyone. The most common features are cold sensation in the palm, Raynaud's, a tender hypothenar eminence. On angiography, you can see a beaded and irregular appearance due to the distal ulnar artery, plus or minus aneurysm formation, and you'll see occlusion or underfilling of the distal ulnar arterioles. Again, the classic imaging appearances in a cutoff of the ulnar artery on angiography and delayed angiographic images. The next case is a 42-year-old male that had that status was angiogram and embolization with persistent right groin pain 48 hours after the procedure. A CT was performed and an ultrasound, which demonstrates an abnormality arising off the common femoral artery with arterialized flow within that sac. And this is a pseudoaneurysm that was caused by access. A pseudoaneurysm is theoretically a disruption in the arterial wall continuity. You have sustained arterial pressure and the blood dissects into the tissues and it forms around those perfuse that communicates with the arterial lumen. The perfuse sac is contained. The treatment for this scenario is typically you're going to try ultrasound guided compression first. And if that doesn't work and the patient has a narrow neck, which in this case they did, you can inject thrombin directly under ultrasound guidance. And if that doesn't work, then you can refer to surgery for management. The next case is a 36-year-old male with recurrent episodes of epistaxis that self-resolve and was admitted for a cerebral abscess. This patient was referred for pulmonary angiography. A pulmonary angiogram was performed, and which is pretty obvious. You can see there's an abnormal arterial connection here to the venous system. And if you look closely, you can see another one here. This is a classic appearance of a pulmonary arterial venous malformation. You have a feeding artery, a nidus, and then a draining vein. So these patients must be treated. This condition is known as hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia. It's autosomal dominant. The criteria are on the chart here, epistaxis, telangiectasias. You can have a visceral lesion as well. And most of, if not all, these patients have some sort of family history that predisposes them to this. The most common things that we see in the interventional radiology setting are pulmonary AVMs, which we will embolize. The typical number that you'll see is if it's greater than 3 millimeters, they'll go to embolization. They serve as, and the reason why these need to be treated is because they serve as a potential conduit for paradoxical embolism. And in this particular case, this patient had a cerebral abscess. And so that's why it's really important to treat these early. The next case is a 39-year-old female with chronic abdominal pain aggravated by lying supine. This patient had a CT angiogram, and there's a pretty classic appearance here. There's stenosis at the level of the celiac axis with post-stenotic dilation, and it's pretty apparent here. So compression followed by post-stenotic dilation, and this is median arcuate ligament syndrome. This is the underlying etiology is compression by the median arcuate ligament, and it causes upper abdominal angina secondary to compression of the celiac trunk, typically in 20 to 40-year-olds. These patients are mostly asymptomatic when it's seen, but they can have chronic abdominal pain. And usually diagnosis is delayed because of it's a very hard diagnosis to come across because they're usually being worked up for other things. The treatment is surgical decompression. You don't want to stent across this because it's a physical compression on it. And so surgery is the treatment for median arcuate ligament syndrome. The next patient is a 43-year-old male with abdominal pain. And you can see on here, this is a patient that presented so taking a look at these images, these are curved reformatted images. There's an abnormal outpouching here of the SMA that's come off. This patient had an SMA aneurysm, a pseudoaneurysm secondary to pancreatitis. We did an angiogram here, measured the exact size of the aneurysm sac and deployed detachable coils inside of the sac and what we felt like may have been another outflow vessel as well. Again, this is a superior mesenteric artery aneurysm. They usually involve the most proximal 5 centimeters of the SMA. There's multiple underlying etiologies, which may be incidental or it can present with abdominal pain and bleeding. Typically, the abdominal pain is one of those flashpoint signs that this could potentially rupture. For us, there is no real size criteria. These should all be treated because they could rupture at any time. Next case is a 31-year-old female with abdominal pain. And this is a patient that also presented, this is a celiac axis angiogram. And just to follow it out, this is proper hepatic and this is splenic. And as we follow here, this is a splenic artery aneurysm that's arising. The most common clinical presentation for this is asymptomatic, but in this patient's case, she had left upper quadrant pain radiating to the subcapsular region. Typically, we will treat these if they're anywhere above 1.5 centimeters, because again, the risk of rupture is very high. We like to delay treating these till after pregnancy because of the risk, the radiation involved in getting to these. They require aneurysm coiling or whatever embolic agent you like to use, such as glue. But the important thing here is that the inflow and the outflow are both treated. Most are between 2 and 4 centimeters. They're asymptomatic and located in the mid to distal aspect of the splenic artery. So again, splenic artery aneurysms, you're going to see them in your portal hypertension patients and your pregnancy patients. And they're associated with formation due to estrogen progesterone, and they can rupture, but we try to not treat these until absolutely necessary. The next patient is a 72-year-old male with melena and a dropping hematocrit. This patient came for mesenteric angiography. This is an SMA injection, which demonstrates active extravasation arising off a very tiny third order branch of the iliacolic artery. This is an acute lower GI hemorrhage. These 21% of GI bleeding have a lower GI source. Most common causes are diverticulosis or angiodysplasia. And this patient was treated with coil embolization. We were able to take a microcatheter out and embolize. So that's the most common way that we will treat these. The next patient is a 62-year-old male with no history of trauma, with back pain and cardiac dysfunction. This is a patient that had a wildly abnormal CT, and this is a CT angio. You see the renal artery perfusing along with the renal vein perfusing at the same time. So this is a very large arteriovenous fistula. This was a non-traumatic. This patient had no symptom or no prior procedures, traumas that he could recall. So this was one where we embolized, we found the nidus and embolized it. There's always a risk of recanalization if you don't completely treat it. And there's always a risk of infarction to the renal artery or to the renal parenchyma as well. So this was a companion case of an 18-year-old that had a traumatic AV fistula arising from the subclavian to other venous branches. We coil embolized this one. So just remember, AV fistulas can be traumatic or non-traumatic as well. So a 72-year-old male with intermittent claudication, and this is an angiographic run to orient you. This is the lower extremity. We are in the superficial femoral artery, and there's an occlusion and what looks like chronic appearing mature collaterals. This is a case where we crossed the occlusion and we were able to recanalize and open this back up. And you'll notice that once you open up direct inline flow to the leg, you'll see resolved collaterals. You won't see those mature collaterals anymore. So this was an SFA occlusion. There's a task system for classifying these lesions. Traditionally, A through C task lesions are endovascular treatment and task D are surgical. But again, as we get better with endovascular therapy and the technology improves, even task D lesions are coming to for endovascular treatment now. These patients present with intermittent claudication and critical limb ischemia. And treatment outcomes are very good overall. This next case is a 76-year-old female undergoing status post EVAR, undergoing routine CT surveillance. In this, the aneurysm sac, there's clearly contrast filling into here. You can see there's an adjacent lumbar artery that's feeding into it. We direct stuck this and we put in 9 milliliters of NBCA and lipidol in a 1-to-2 ratio. And we were able to adequately treat this endoleak. Type 2 endoleak, it's the most common type of endoleak that you can see. It's important to treat this because you can rupture. It's 40%, and typically it's either an IMA, a mesenteric vessel, or a lumbar. Many do close spontaneously, so you can observe. However, with that being said, you need to make sure you serially follow these patients in order to treat them appropriately. Again, type 1 through 5 classification system, with type 2 being the most common situation. Okay, and that concludes the arterial section of the rapid review cases.